What up, Internet? This is the Pop Geek Podcast number 19.
19, we made it.
And yeah, we got a whole bunch of stuff to do. I doubt we'll get to all of it, so.
Oh my god, this week was like trailer after trailer after trailer drops.
It's been unbelievable. Like, of course Star Wars is in the mix, because it's always in the mix. So just to kick us off, I'll lay it out for us. We're going to do the Turtles. We're going to go X-Men Apocalypse. We're going to do Star Wars, the Chinese one. Mix it up a little bit. Yeah,
it was a good one.
Yeah, it was a good one. You know, it's I can read Chinese, which is not true at all. then we're going to talk about PSX real quick and kind of an abstract, because everyone else has covered it already. You know, if you follow IGN or anybody else, or if you're a PlayStation fan or a PlayStation owner, you know all the stuff that came out. But we got a couple of thoughts on kind of the future of what they're doing, and a couple of the games that came out. And then
some of the new updates for some games, like DLC and releases, updates. And then like Sparrow Racing that Destiny just released. So we'll talk all about that.
Which is going to be huge, yeah. So, but we're going to kick it off first with the Ninja Turtles trailer.
Yes.
So it was kind of cool. Last week we were talking about Turtles because of the game that was leaked out on the Australian ratings board. And then, boom, this week we get a trailer. And what's kind of funny, I don't know why I was weirdly blindsided by this. Like, I knew it had to be in the works. Like, you're going to get three films. It's Michael Bay. It's already made enough money. It's been established. It's going to be three, probably. Because the Transformers movies were terrible, and we still got four of those.
Yeah.
So what I'll say about the trailer is I like it. It's kind of weird. Like, when the first one came out and they kind of took time to reveal the giant turtles.
Right.
That took some getting used to. But now that I'm kind of used to it, the trailer kicks off right off the bat and you're right into the turtle wagon.
Yeah.
And they're firing, manhole covers at people, which is ridiculous, but awesome. Could you imagine? That's like a 150-pound projectile just like ripping through a person in the side of a car. And, I mean, it's silly. I don't care. I think it's going to be all right. Like, because the best part, too, already done origin story.
Yeah.
So now we're just going to get into silly-ass turtle stuff and mutants and more mutants and...
Yes, that's a big draw. They got Bebop and Rocksteady both in the trailer. They look awesome. Yeah. They kept their personalities. They're fun. They're not just kind of bumbling idiots where yet to be seen, but they actually got Jose rebuttal with Mikey and stuff like that.
Yeah. I kind of like that it's them.
Yeah.
Because what did we get? Razor and...
Toka and Razor
were the ones they had to use for the other film series,
right?
Because they couldn't get the rights to Bebop and Rocksteady, who I believe were exclusive to the cartoon series.
Yeah.
Right?
The creators of the cartoon series, from what I understand, own the rights to those two characters and just wouldn't release them for whatever reason.
Yeah. That's always that weird thing. It's like, you got to hold on to it.
Because they wanted the movie to suck.
Yeah. Oh, come on. That movie had Vanilla Ice live performance in it.
Ninja Rap, baby.
Yeah. And again, you know, I mean, it has a certain level of silly that you're willing to accept.
Yeah.
The only thing I'll knock the first film for was, as a adult consumer of it, I felt like an idiot. Like the storytelling was kind of like...
dumbed down.
It was fun. You know, it was fun. My son liked it. You know, stuff like that. But this seems more fun because you don't have to go through origin story. You don't have to deal with lore of Turtles.
Right.
Really. Now you're just kind of in your own world. You've established who they are. You already know their personalities. You get kind of a glimpse, I believe, of Shredder. I think that's a Shredder or somebody who has the claws on.
It was Shredder, but it looked like a different... actor.
Yeah, he seems smaller.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, so maybe this is something a little bit different. Also, you see Tyler Perry as Baxter Stockman.
I think that's going to be awesome.
Which is kind of awesome. Which is kind of funny, too, because he's a really big dude.
Yeah.
He's like 6'5". He's like a giant man. But also, he plays a great tool.
Yeah, he does.
And I'm hoping Madea's in this. So I think it's Madea does Manhattan.
The only drawback, the only thing I didn't like about the trailer was that they finally revealed Casey Jones.
Yes.
Even though he was already revealed before, but now we get to see him in action.
Yeah.
He's not the grudgy looking hockey guy that we're used to. He's all clean cut.
The guy from Arrow.
I know it's the guy from Arrow, but still, like, he's put some scruff on him or something, like some long hair wig.
He has perpetual scruff, like whatever that is.
Yeah, he's got to be like a dude's dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the original Casey Jones from the film was good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and he's dirty looking in every role he does. He's always looks like he just didn't shower.
Yeah.
He's got half a beard, no matter what. Yeah. And a little more believable. Some of the goofy hockey stuff that they're putting in there is a little weird. I saw, and like, he doesn't look like he can skate. that comes from me. I mean, I played hockey for a lot of years, and you can tell when actors could skate a little bit, and I'm not sure the guy from Arrow could skate, because he kind of looks a little silly. And then that kind of leads into, you see Bebop and Rocksteady kind of tearing some stuff up, and you see there's a point where Rocksteady jumps down onto all fours, and he's running like a rhino, and that's the only part where I went, oh, that's right, this is kind of cartoony.
Yeah, the animation just looked out of place from all from everything else in the trailer. Everything else looked great. It all fit.
Which is funny. Standing up,
yeah,
he looks like a rhinoceros standing up, and I believe that. But like running like a rhinoceros, I'm like, this is a cartoon. This is silly, you know. But again, I think I'm totally fine with this.
Yeah,
I'm
on board. Hopefully he survives because he's endangered.
Right. He's really endangered, yeah. So, I mean, I think it's going to be fine. Michael Bay, hey, man, a lot of shit's going to explode. It's going to be dumb and whatever. But
it was kind of weird to see the Transformers fly out of the sky and decimate the world.
So, yeah, we're getting some of that in this.
Yeah.
There's some sort of alien invasion, and I don't know if it's Krang.
What else could it be?
Yeah, I would assume because this is going to have to establish the Dimension X storyline. But then that also brings in that weird ooze storyline and how sometimes the ooze came from there or sometimes it didn't, depending on which Turtles iteration you're talking about. Because I didn't know that most of them have a little bit different storyline.
Yeah.
My son was watching something about the new cartoon series that's out now, and they do the whole Dimension X is the ooze, so the Turtles are technically part of this, but also like April can see through time.
Yeah, it's a little weird. They all have some kind of alien gene in them or something like that. Yeah.
And then for the basic fan, if you want to see Megan Fox wear a schoolgirl outfit, she does do that, and that's an important selling point to the Turtles.
That's a plus.
Yeah, it's not bad. So okay, that does it for Turtles. Unless you've got something else you want to talk about. No, I was excited for Bebop and Rocksteady.
Yeah, so was I. I'm really happy to see them.
I think that's going to be a lot of fun. Next up is X-Men Apocalypse. Talk about two very different trailers for some super comic book movies.
Right.
That Apocalypse trailer is fucking dark. Like, even the look of the film is dark. Everything is dark. They're talking about, you know, end of the world. Everything is bad. The hard part for me is this is a bit of a blind spot for me. Like I said, I'm a big... big Batman fan. Yeah. I like Batman. Batman's pretty simple in terms of his story. X-Men is really tough to follow without chunks. Like, I know the beginning stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I know Wolverine stuff. That stuff. I'm all clear on that.
They covered it pretty thoroughly.
Yeah, and the movies did a pretty good job. The Apocalypse section of where we're headed now, and now that we have the two casts, has completely screwed me up. Like, I didn't know, I don't know why, that this was taking place in the 1980s. Like, First Class, you know, was like the 70s.
Yeah.
And they're kind of coming forward. And then you're seeing, like, which I love, is, like, Xavier, like, sitting there in his, like, total Crockett and Tubbs outfit he's got going on. You know, he's got the Miami Vice and the hair and everything. I'm like, all right, well, I forget that this is a period piece. And I forget that this was when it actually took place in the story, too.
They really should have Jon Hammer do the soundtrack.
They should, man. Just do some synth, popping that shit over top. Oh, yeah, man. But, like, the whole Apocalypse thing is he's kind of a living god, but he's not really. But he's also, like, completely unstoppable, which I've always been surprised about. They do that in a couple of different comics where there's, like, I think Darkseid is kind of in that, too, in DC.
Yeah, there's Darkseid, Apocalypse, there's a third guy.
There's a third guy, too, that's, like, pretty much an unstoppable villain, but, like, you could foil their plan.
Yeah,
but you're not going to take
them out.
Or
trap them somewhere.
Yeah, or trap them in some other... place,
and I didn't know this about Apocalypse because I'm not very familiar with the character. I just know he's like the big baddie of the X-Men's universe. That I guess he can control other mutants, and that's how he's able to control four particular mutants to stay with them at all times, or the most powerful mutants,
right? And there's some of the like four horsemen of the Apocalypse, type of thing that he had done this in the past.
That's
to,
where the story comes from,
that was pretty cool. He was possibly the god type character that the Egyptians interacted with and stuff like that. So it's going to be kind of funky. And the recasting. So Storm is now a different actress.
Well, she's got to be younger.
Right, has to be the younger one. But
and Jean Grey and
Jean Grey is now in it. Jubilee is now in it.
Jubilee, Scott Summers, or Cyclops is going to be in it.
See, but that's strange to me too, because Jubilee occurs later in my brain. Like, she should have been in the house with Rogue and all them in the other film series.
Yeah, she's
like, I thought that's where she lives.
Appearing too. I think from because I'm used to the cartoon and the comics. That's I think she's appearing too soon. She needs to appear when Scott and Jean are already adults.
Yeah, that's what I thought too.
Yeah, these guys are more young adults, I guess.
Yeah. So I mean, it's gonna be super epic. What I'm surprised about a little bit, no flap about his look. The pictures were released a long time ago. We knew what he was gonna look like.
He looked like Ivan Ooze.
Yeah, he does look exactly like Ivan Ooze from Power Rangers, and he doesn't look like the Apocalypse that we all know. Like, I know what Apocalypse looks like, and he doesn't look like that.
But I did like how with now the color correction and everything that they've done with the movie and the footage, he looks better.
Yeah.
He looks menacing. He looks dark. He looks, you know, gritty. Like,
the only thing I'll say is he looks very space-agey.
Yeah.
That'd be my only complaint. His outfit and his overall look is kind of outer space, even though he probably should. I mean, he's technically from or whatever, but
yeah,
he should look almost more
ancient.
Yeah.
Same thing with Magneto's costume and Storm's costume. They all kind of mimic his look, and they're very same thing, sci-fi, space age, futuristic.
And also, they kind of left Psylocke out of the trailer. You see her face close up, and that's the only shot you see of Olivia Munn in the entire thing.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
I mean, her costume is borderline dirty, so I mean, maybe they just left that out for the trailer. Because it's cut real high up on her thigh and everything. So yeah, I don't know. But yeah, I mean, I'm excited about it. But like I said, I'm kind of hitting this weird blind spot with X-Men, which is I know certain things, but then certain stories I don't. And
well, they wouldn't want you to know too much,
right? Well, also, this is not part of the MCU. This is Sony,
right?
So this is not Avengers. This is not any of that stuff that we all know that is all related. This is like its own thing. And it's its own thing on top of Wolverine. And I think Deadpool is on his own too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's not MCU either.
I can't wait for Deadpool. It's going to be so much fun.
That's going to be great too, yeah. You know, and maybe they'll mix him because this Apocalypse story, I think, is going to spread because he's a pretty epic bad guy. This could go on a while.
Yeah.
So this might be a 1-2 film. You know, who knows? I do like what they've done. It's so much more serious than the other stuff.
Yeah,
because even Avengers is silly at times, but this is kind of, I mean, this is dark stuff. So this is going to be kind of fun.
Did you see the picture of Deadpool floating around Facebook wearing a stormtrooper?
Yeah, he's like, they will never know.
They have no idea.
I posted this to our Facebook page, if anybody saw it, the Tina Fey and Amy Poehler movie that's coming out.
Mm-hmm.
They did a whole trailer where they're like pretending to be the Star Wars people, kind of a little bit, and they're like, the whole thing was like hashtag you could see them both because they're opening the same day as Star Wars.
So was the Alvin and the Chipmunks movie too.
Oh, wow. it was different audience right there.
Decisions.
Yeah, right. Really, man. I don't know. How did they make another one of those?
Movie hop.
Did kids see those?
I don't know.
Like, my son doesn't even like it. He's scared to death of it.
Really? Well, I remember when I was a kid, I would watch the animated
I love this, the cartoon show. Yeah.
I grew up with it.
Yeah. Oh, maybe it's just we're too old now.
Yeah. All right. The other thing is the Star Wars Chinese trailer, because this is the Pop Geek podcast and we're going to talk about Star Wars for a while. Because
that's how we roll.
Right. So, a lot of the stuff we've seen before.
Yeah.
It's getting to the point now where, like, we just need the movie to drop.
Right.
Which it drops this week. I got my tickets. I'm going to go camp outside for no goddamn reason.
Well, did you hear that the guys said they. Grauman's Chinese Theater already camping out like 3 weeks ahead of the release date.
Get tickets, man. Like, this isn't the past where you had to be at the window when the shit went on sale. Like, come on.
Well, that's what they said. They're like, we already got our tickets. We already got our assigned seats and everything, but it's just tradition. We've just done it every Star Wars movie ever since. So they just do it. And I think I heard it's also for charity now, too. They're probably
bringing awareness. Oh, they're doing like a sit thing?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So it's makes for a good cause. Sense. But that's it's like, really?
Yeah. And I've seen some of the shots, too. Like, these are guys who've been outside for a while before.
Yeah, yeah. Oh,
because
yeah.
There's like, they're all bearded dreadlock dudes. I'm like, I don't know. You know, got time off from the Apple store or wherever the fuck you were.
Right.
But like,
So Star Wars trailer, we got some new footage. Yeah, new footage. Just more like extensions of what we've already seen.
Yeah, it was a lot of like, here's a shot of Finn and Rey, and it's a little longer this time. And you're like, oh, they're just kind of standing there longer.
But dude, seeing that Millennium Falcon crash, I'm like,
yeah,
I want to know what happens.
So that and the line about BB-8 are the only two things that that are the real takeaways. Or there's three things.
Yeah.
So you see the Millennium Falcon crash on a snow planet, which I believe is the one they created just for this.
Yes.
That's in Battlefront. I forgot the name of it. So you see it crash, which is not a good thing, because that's an old ship, and we already know it's a hunk of junk.
Yeah.
The thing about BB-8 is it's extended, because we've seen this all before. It's him and Rey kicking around on Jakku, doing whatever. She's talking to BB-8 and says, where are you from? And he says it's classified in beeps and boops, which she is somehow able to ascertain.
Well, they've always been able to do that, even with R2-D2. It's like,
yeah, everyone understands them. It's like Stewie, you know.
Her story's classified too, though.
Yeah, so, but she says, okay. Oh, mine's classified too. But that also, it's what is BB-8 then?
Yeah,
because he looks like an astromech droid, sort of, in that they all kind of look the same. You know that he goes in ships because there's a shot of, I think, with him and Poe Dameron.
Yeah.
And he is in the seat that R2 would sit in. So he's like, he's a form of astromech droid. But it's kind of interesting. It's kind of the classified. So then you get kind of that crossover, that R2-D2 on his own mission to find Obi-Wan in the first film.
There's
stuff like
a
that.
Perfectly logical explanation for this, because our government classifies everything to do with aliens. So
he's an alien?
Yeah.
Alien robot.
Makes perfect sense.
Yeah, well, I mean, when aliens are everywhere, though, do you need to classify them at this point? So.
Well, it'll be declassified like 30 years from now.
Yeah, so. Yeah, just for absolutely no reason.
And they'll just say it was a weather balloon.
Yeah. So then the third takeaway is you hear a second voice in the trailer that's deep and scary, that's not behind a mask. You know, like when you hear Kylo Ren's voice, it's very much Darth Vader or Bane. It's You're very right. Bane-esque, actually. And this is a clear, rough-sounding voice.
I will finish what you started.
Yeah, well, that's Kylo Ren. Yeah. But the assumption on my part is that it's Emperor Snoke, or Supreme Leader Snoke.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
That's the voice you're hearing there. And it's about wiping out the rebellion one last time or something like that. And that's an interesting little nugget, because that's a voice without a face. Mm-hmm. We don't know that face. We know it's not Luke Skywalker, who they've also not revealed, but he's listed in the credits of the movie. Go to IMDb. He's clearly in the film.
He's shown up at appearances, so it's like he's in it.
Yeah, he's in the movie. So, but it's kind of interesting. I think it should be the first we've heard the voice.
Yeah, I haven't heard anything of the voice yet.
And I mean, it doesn't really help that it's Andy Serkis, who is Gollum and a lot of other people, and so his voice does mask really well. I can't listen to it and hear Andy Serkis in it.
Yeah.
Because it's not British, and he's not talking like this when he's not a character. So that's kind of the interesting thing from the Star Wars trailer. So I think that about does it for trailer talk.
Yeah, so that was a lot.
Now let's move on to PSX, and we'll talk some video games.
Sweet.
All right, so let's cover PSX. Just wrapped up this last week. And good news, bad news.
I heard it started strong and then it kind of petered out at the end.
Like, I mean, PlayStation is killing Xbox. We all know this. But like what Xbox did at Gamescom was like PlayStation tried to do it at Paris. But then they followed it directly up with PSX. So it's like they had to save a little bit, you know, because you can't just blow it all out.
Yeah.
But then they ended up kind of blowing their wad early in the show. They jumped out there on stage and went Uncharted 4, and everybody went wow, and everybody was super excited. And they go, well, you think that's cool? Final Fantasy 7 remake, and we're, you know, and it looks amazing.
Yeah.
So you got these two massive games to start the show, and then it's like, we got VR, and it doesn't work too good, and we only got four games. So it's like,
yeah.
So we're talking about it a little bit. Like Uncharted looks amazing. It always does.
It's going to sell so many copies.
It's a really good game. It's a unique PlayStation only. Final Fantasy VII. Again, I'm not big in the Final Fantasy world.
Yeah.
VII is apparently the most popular one, because the Cloud character also got ported to
Smash Brothers,
which is huge. So, but it has like real battle mechanics. Like, you're swinging a sword and not waiting your turn anymore.
You see, I've always hated that about the JRPGs, is that it's always turn-based battling, and I just can't play that.
So. Yeah, I mean, it's too slow for me.
I can't do RPGs for that reason alone.
I can kind of see XCOM. Have you seen XCOM?
Yeah, yeah.
That's kind of a little bit neater. I could get into that. But this is like full-on, he's on the street chopping people with a sword. And then they showed another sequence where he's full run, and then he goes in between a wall and another thing where it looks like Tomb Raider.
Okay.
Where it's like, here you're controlling him, boom, it jumps into a little bit of the movie, and then you're controlling him again on the other side.
Nice.
So that looks pretty cool. And I think that'll turn on a lot more fans to that story. It's kind of weird to start at 7, though. And then, like, 11 is good, and, like, I don't even know what number they're on at this point.
Yeah, 13 times 4 or whatever.
And then they have different versions of it. The other big news concerning that is it's episodic, which is really cool.
Oh.
So it's going to be, like, almost like a Telltale game where you get a little bit of content at a time, and it's issued out. But it's as much as you like. And, you know, Final Fantasy people aren't going to, you know, go halfway with this.
No, they're going to buy a season pass right up front.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting way to dole out this content, though, to go episodic with kind of a... I mean, this is a AAA title to go episodic with. So that's really cool. The other thing is the VR. So this kind of let everyone down. We all knew this was kind of coming. Sony is going super hard with the VR.
Yeah, they are.
The downside is they don't have the content to follow it up. So they did a demo. Even the demo didn't go very well. Like, it was glitchy and weird. The Move controller, it works, but it doesn't. There's a little bit of a lag sometimes. Also, when you're showing it to people, the user is wearing the headset.
Right.
Which is not really great to see when you're sitting in an audience and the head's going like this, and he was trying to hit a ball or something like that in one of the games.
I just hope that Sony doesn't, you know, release it prematurely and have it pretty much end up like Sega CD.
Exactly. And I think that's what a lot of people are worried about.
Yeah.
And this is going to be, they still won't say price. They haven't said a price, but they said it's going to be console level. Jeez. So you're talking about a $500 investment, or roughly. It could be four, something in there.
And again, this headset has to be plugged into the PlayStation, or is it a separate unit?
Supposedly its own unit.
Okay.
It's like its own console. But the games they have that are listed now is that they got four big ones that they demoed, or at least they showed, which is one is Rez. Rez, a lot of people, I guess, are fans of this. There's an earlier version of this. It's a really abstract game where you're kind of the shapeless body and you fly around and shoot stuff with your head. That's as far as I can tell. It looks like what you think virtual reality was going to look like. You know, like if you saw a Lawnmower Man or something like that, where you're just kind of this weird thing floating around. So there's that. There's Psychonauts is now got a prequel game that's going to be for the VR.
That would be
which
cool.
Which is kind of cool. This is not the crowdfunded sequel that everyone knows about.
Yeah.
This is going to be a separate game. It's totally different for Psychonauts. Then there's Eagle Flight, which looks amazing. No one knows what you do in the game. You're an eagle flying around. The only clue you get is you kind of fly through some buildings during the demo. So maybe it's like you got to hit different, you know, checkpoints, something like that. There's also a point where two players joined him. So you see your two friends who are with you, so it's multiplayer.
Yeah, but it didn't really seem like you could control the bird. You just kind of followed
it. Yeah.
I don't know. It's weird.
So I don't know. That was kind of funny. The one that looks great is 100-foot robot golf, which is exactly as silly as it sounds. It is like you're a big-ass robot. There's another big-ass robot. You're playing golf in a city and destroying the city simultaneously. So that sounds great.
Yeah, that sounds like fun.
I don't know how it's going to translate to VR, but the demo looks kind of cool.
I'd play it.
I would play it right now.
Yeah.
So like on the VR front, this is VR.
Right, and that costs you what?
Is Google Cardboard. It is $16. Now, I've shown this to both of you. This is the coolest AFK I've ever played with. Like
for,
I love
for,
my Xbox,
for a piece of cardboard, that thing's awesome.
This thing is ridiculous. Yeah. It's, you know, two eyepieces. It's a piece of cardboard that they tell you how to fold into this shape. And it's $16. The company is called 81 Brands. So if you guys want a cool black one, they make black ones. Most of the other ones are brown. Verizon has one that now comes with the Star Wars app. If you got the Star Wars app on your phone, they have the Joku Spy app, which has the cool Star Wars content that builds up to the movie. So every 2 days you get a message from BB-8 and you watch this cool video in the head unit. But in terms of gameplay, there's really nothing there.
Yeah, when I...
Like, I don't play with this. You watch stuff with it.
Right.
And it's awesome. 360 video is amazing. Like, you get to, like, look around. And there's a point where, like, there's one where there's a gorilla are walking around. He comes up to the camera and, like, gets super close to you. You start backing up. And I'm, like, in my living room and I'm about to trip over something because I think the gorilla is that close to me. It's funny.
Well, when I saw the gorilla, I got scared. I thought he was going to throw a piece of shit at me. Yeah. That's what they do, right?
That's actually the next one, yeah. It's called Shit Thrower. You start ducking them, yeah. So, like, I mean, $16 or $400.
Right.
I don't know, man. I just hope they need the killer app is what they need.
Well, they got to also work on movement because, again, that's a great experience because you're standing still and just looking.
You're just looking.
You know, with the VR from PlayStation, you're supposed to be moving in a 3D space, but they haven't really shown how you do that. You're just kind of following people.
Because we know it's not the Oculus Rift.
No.
Because the Rift has its own unit that you walk in.
Right.
This has one button. And it's actually, it's like a ViewMaster. And ViewMaster makes their own one of these. It's like $30. The ViewMaster, the company.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I put my phone in it. I have VR. I'm able to watch 360 video. There are games, but they're pretty goofy. Like, you just kind of point and click things.
Yeah.
The problem with having VR in your living room is you're going to have a lot of broken furniture.
Yes. And we talked about this, too. The seclusion factor of not knowing where you are. Because I've almost fallen over using this.
Yeah.
Because there's one of the Star Wars ones, the camera moves like this, and you start to... Your balance starts to go because, I mean, you're immersed. Your vision.
Well, I can see so many kids getting hit in the head while you're swinging a virtual bat around or something. Because, I mean, you've seen that with the Kinect. Some guys are... Doing the ski thing and they smack their kid in the head. Yeah.
The solution is simple. You just set it up in a padded asylum room and you're set.
Your game room will have to be padded.
Here we go. We need to patent and invest in a adult playpen for VR.
That keeps you from knocking your giant television over.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I mean, as far as VR goes, man, I'm in on this. You know,
$16, I like that
$16. Everybody I know for Christmas is getting one of these because I'll spend $16 on anybody. So, on top of that, Destiny had a big reveal, at PSX, which is kind of unexpected. Destiny, though, I mean, PlayStation has a big hold in Destiny.
Yeah, they do.
Because all of the commercials are PlayStation commercials for Destiny.
I really hope that Xbox after this and when Destiny 2 finally comes out, that it'll be done with the stupid exclusivity thing because it's really pissing me off.
It's annoying. But the main thing is Sparrow Racing League.
Yeah, the fans wanted it. They cried for it and they begged for it. We got it.
Yes, and I love it.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
I mean, a lot of people are bitching there's only two maps. I don't care.
Yeah, it's free.
New. I get tons of free loot every time I play.
I'm sure that'll be expanded soon,
too. Yeah. Well, it's going to run 3 weeks and then they're going to shut it off.
Yeah.
Which all they're doing and what Destiny has always done is run stats constantly. That's what they're doing. They want you to play so that they can see what you're doing and then they modify the game to that. I guarantee you there's going to be more maps.
Yeah.
The way the gameplay has always been set up is it's first-person shooter with MMO stuff built into it. And then on top of this, I always thought it was weird. I'm like, why do I have this Sparrow that can only take me to my next location? That's all it could do. You also have a ship that you could modify and do all this stuff to, but all it could do is take you to the next level.
Yeah.
So, like, there's so many pieces that this game could possibly be by the end.
Well, it's actually interesting, to get amazing. A hovercraft racing game in a shooter engine.
Yeah.
It's like, they did a good job, I thought, for
Yeah, I thought it feels good. It feels fast. I feel, like, excited when I'm driving. The only thing is, like, I want to do, though, is I want it to be full Mario Kart. It just be, like, smoking each other,
throwing grenades at each other and dropping bombs.
Or have that be a playable level, because it counts as Crucible, and Crucible is the PvP. So, like, yeah, why not? Why not have a battle form version of it, where you're buzzing
shoot
each other.
Shooting turtle shells.
Yeah, shooting turtle shells at each other. Yeah. So, but yeah, Destiny, the Racing League is a lot of fun. I think that's a good thing for Destiny, and it opens up a lot of doors for the future of that game. Now, GTA 5 came out, was it yesterday, I think? It was like 2 days ago.
It was a couple
and
days Adam's ago,
And Adam's the big GTA guy, so he jumped all over this like, I had no idea.
I've been super
but
excited.
But this DLC is massive.
Yeah.
Like, it's going to be awesome.
Crazy for a DLC.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, they've got a lot of things that I've been waiting for a long time.
Now, do you have enough money built up in the game to afford any of this shit?
Not like, really. I haven't really had enough time to play. But no, since they finally put the heist out, you're able to make a lot more money now. So that helps tremendously.
Just so we cover it, what is it exactly? It's mostly luxury items.
Yeah.
Right? They're opening up houses now. You can fully customize your apartment.
Mm-hmm.
You get yachts.
Cars.
And new cars. There's a whole bunch of new cars.
They release new cars all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's going to be some new weapons. There's the big thing is, you know, you've always had several different apartments to choose from. Now you can not only customize those apartments, but you can also get houses in the Vinewood Hills, like the that are on the stilts that are like, you know, luxury houses and so forth.
But
the big thing is these yachts. These yachts are going to be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like, if you've seen the trailer, the yachts are just awesome. Yeah. I mean, I can't explain it any better way than that. But now, the thing that I really want to see from Rockstar is I want them to open up Vice City and Liberty City. And remember, and from San Andreas, you had Las Venturas, which was like the Vegas in the GTA world. And then you had San Fierro, which was San Francisco. Yeah. That would be great if you could actually fly to those places from, Los Santos.
Yeah.
And, you know, I see it as possible. You know, it's going to take a lot of programming, a lot of time, but I think this is something that we could see in the future.
This could get into like what we were talking about with Crackdown, which is once that cloud-based processing could happen, I don't see why you wouldn't actually be able to move that way. It could be preloaded on another server, and then literally your information would send to another server as your little plane made the flight, or it would be like a go-to-sleep.
If you had like a GPS in the plane, because I mean, you have already like with one of the more recent updates, you have the first person view in the cockpit of the plane, so you can actually see all the avionics and all the, you know, little bells and whistles and so forth.
Like, you know, the aviator program that Microsoft uses.
It's pretty cool.
And what if they did this? What if GTA Online became more of like a Destiny type game where it's just or even World of Warcraft where You buy the game online.
Don't compare GTA to WoW.
I'm just saying, as far as like, it'll come with a new expansion like that, and so they'll add Liberty City, and all you do is you pay the $40 to add that chunk
to
the game.
To
you know,
that'd be kind of cool.
And then you know,
I'd pay for it.
Yeah, and there's no longer a GTA 6 or whatever. It's just constantly
adding new
characters, new maps.
And now that they have like a solid online platform, because GTA 4 had an online platform, it was terrible.
Yeah.
And you know, with 5, they've really done a great job with it. And
yeah, I heard a couple people griping about earlier updates where it was just like a shirt. You know, like there was like these little DLCs that everybody wasn't really enthused about. And then all of a sudden they're like, well, you guys want it? Boom. And they hit you with this. And this is unreal.
And this is free, right? I haven't heard anything about price.
I believe it's free.
All the updates have been free.
That's just amazing.
That game makes money like nobody's business.
Oh, yeah. They've made $2 billion off that game. So, I mean, they're doing fine with it. I mean, obviously it costs money to make that kind of content. But, I mean, people are eating it up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it comes out Tuesday, guys. So by the time we post,
by the time we post this, it'll be out. The last one is a DLC. Actually, we got a couple more things to talk about, but in the DLC front is the Jack the Ripper DLC.
Yeah.
For Assassin's Creed is coming out.
Same time as the GTA on Tuesday.
Is it really? Is it the same? Okay.
Yeah, that's the release date.
And this is for Syndicate.
Yeah, for Syndicate.
Okay.
It's gonna be another little small story missions. Multiple story missions, following Evie Fry and her hunt to capture or kill Jack the Ripper, which I think is a really cool story.
There was initially somebody was saying that you might actually get to be Jack the Ripper, or you might be him and not know it.
Yeah, the trailer leaves it open to interpretation.
Yeah.
But from what the article said here is that you're going to be joining forces with one of the inspectors, Frederick Aberlane, as you hunt down Jack the Ripper. You're going to be playing as Evie 20 years after the events of the Syndicate storyline, which is kind of weird because Evie looks perfectly the same as
that's kind of
as in the storyline. Yeah. So I'm like, is she supposed to be older or is she just like immortal? I don't know.
Right.
But somebody in the article mentioned like something happens, I guess, to Jacob in the story. I haven't finished Syndicate. I don't know what happens to Jacob in the story. So they kind of hinted that maybe Jack the Ripper is Jacob.
Right.
Maybe.
So yeah, I heard a couple of different rumors. A couple of people were kind of upset that it was like an update, but not an update. But I'm like, new content's new content. Yeah, I don't see why you would be upset about trying something new.
Yeah, and Assassin's Creed has always done this, where the DLC is like another little set of missions based on one particular historical character.
Moment, yeah.
I think Jack the Ripper is a perfect spot. He'll be
the darkest thing ever, is to go straight Manhunt on that thing and you're Jack the Ripper. Do you remember Manhunt?
Oh,
that was the most disgusting game I ever played. It was awesome, though. You could, like, saw people's heads off and shit.
You kind of already do that in the Assassin's Creed world.
That's
kind of
true.
You can kill other gang, rival gang members and cops without any problem. So what's the point of just switching roles and becoming Jack the Ripper and just killing citizens? But
killing citizens. Yeah, it's killing hookers, mostly.
Yeah.
And then now we're back to GTA, so...
But I think it's going to be a really cool DLC. I'm looking forward to it. I think I might spend the money to get this DLC.
That'd be cool. Yeah, and if you guys know Superfan Eric, right?
Mm-hmm.
You Twitch feed a bunch of Syndicate the other night. You had quite a few people doing it. I was watching you do it. We're going to start posting more like when we do it. I'm going to start doing Mondays and Tuesdays. I'll probably just do Destiny just because that's what I do all the time anyway. So there's that. The other thing I wanted to mention is that Full Throttle is getting a remake, and Full Throttle is my favorite video game of all time. It might only be on PlayStation,
maybe,
which will suck for me. But I'm gonna have to pony up $400 and get myself a PlayStation so I can play Full Throttle. But so is Day of the Tentacle.
You're gonna have to pony up more than $400 because you're gonna have to get some of the games that I have so we can actually play together.
Yeah. So there's that, and also Ratchet and Clank are.
Oh, yeah.
I heard they're going to get a new game. So you're going to get a new probably platformer. Well, it's not platformer. What is that? Third person shooter.
Yeah, it's I'll call it a platformer. It's the same vein as like Banjo Kazooie and Mario.
Yeah, just like that. Yeah. So I mean, that's kind of cool. A lot of people love Ratchet and Clank. I think it's a good property. It's a good whatever. But that was all little nuggets that were listed at PSX.
Yeah.
Just want to throw those in at the end. And then finally, before we wrap things up, Eric and I are going to be running the Super Spartan Race in Las Vegas,
right.
But it's in Arizona. but if anyone wants to join us, if you want to come and run the race,
yeah, I mean, be part of our team.
You can email us or hit us up on Facebook. You can get a hold of us any way you want. Our email is popgeekpodcast@gmail.com. Hit us on Facebook if you want to kind of join up. We'll give you the name of the group. We'll probably be the Kessel Runners again.
Yeah, it's our go-to group
so
name.
Far it's just me and Eric. We got a couple other people who are interested, and
parsecs he can do it in.
There's a great Groupon right now, guys, on Groupon. It's only $80 for the race, where it's normally like 160 or 150 or something.
Spartan races are usually stupid expensive. So when that popped, that's why I did it. And I texted it to you and a couple other people. I've been wanting to do the harder one. We did the badass dash, and that was only 3 miles and a couple of obstacles. This will be pretty intense, I got the feeling.
Yeah, and I've done all the ranges of Spartan races and tough motors, so I know what to expect. So it'll be really interesting to see you go through it.
It's going to be great. We'll make sure we film a lot of it as I hurt myself and fall down and cut myself up doing this stupid thing. But I think that about does it for this week. We will see you guys next time.
Take it easy, guys.
Take care.
Hey, guys. I hope you're enjoying the show, but we'd like to hear from you. So please leave a comment below and tell us something you'd like to see on an upcoming show or your thoughts and feelings. Or you can tell us that we suck. Maybe don't do that, because we're a little fragile.